At that point, I was like, Klima, yo, turn it off. Welcome back to my channel. If you haven't subscribed yet, then make sure that you click the subscribe button below and join the revolution. We are on the road to 3K. Let's go. We have to get to 3,000 subscribers before my birthday. My birthday is on the 12th of August, so we need to, that's my birthday wish, that's my birthday gift, that's what I want, that's all I need from you, is for you to subscribe if you haven't, and to share this with people who you think would want to hear it or would be interested in the channel. So it is quarantine season, and I decided that since I am stuck in America for my whole summer vacation, that I might as well give you guys a bit more insight about what it's like living in America. So today's video, I'm gonna be talking about the cultural shock / differences that I experienced as a South African in America. The first cultural shock that I experienced when I came to America was school shooting training.
Guys,
she wasn't ready.
When I tell you that as part of my freshman orientation, we had to go through a course, or not a course, but a training where they tell us what to do if ever there is a school shooting.
Jesus is Lord.
They were like,
what do you do if there's an active shooter in your school?
Run.
At that point, I was like, Klima, yo, turn it off. But I mean, that's something that American schools really do have to do, because they have so many school shootings. Let me just slip this in there. What is white privilege? White privilege is having your race do most school shootings and not have the entire race be considered as a terrorist group or terrorist. I'm just gonna throw that out there, sprinkle that quickly, but that's not the point. Anyway, it is actually necessary for schools here to have school shooting training because they have so many. And I won't even lie, guys, that really creeped me out. That's a big cultural shock for me, because in all of my schooling in South Africa, never have I ever needed a school shooting training course. And to make things worse, my brother sent me a message and he was like, listen man, you need to make friends with all like the weirdos at your school. You have to scope them out, make friends with them, so if there's ever a school shooting, they'll text you and be like, don't come to school today, my girl. And then he was like, but be careful, because don't let them fall in love with you and then you reject them, because they're probably gonna come for you first.
Surprise, mother.
The second cultural shock that I had, which also came with my freshman orientation training, was you have to ask people, what are your pronouns? So basically, just because you see someone who looks physically like a woman, it doesn't mean that you should assume that they want you to call them she, her, hers. But instead, they could want to be called they, them, theirs. That for me was a major shock, because in all my schooling in South Africa, I have never experienced that before. You know, if you see a boy, it's a boy. If you see a girl, it's a girl, unless someone comes and tells you otherwise. But even in SA, I've never had someone come and tell me otherwise. My friend who goes to UCT told me that apparently they do have that there. I actually have come across some people whose pronouns are they, them, theirs. And you might find that sometimes if I see someone who looks like a woman, I'll naturally be like, hey girl, or she, her, hers. And then they have to correct me and be like, no, I prefer they, them, theirs. It was kind of trippy for me, not because there are people who have like different pronouns, but rather because when I was forming an English sentence, it was a bit tricky to be talking about someone who I perceive to be a girl and be like, oh well, there they are, when I'm talking about one person, or let's go with them and I'm talking about one person. That's where it was a bit tricky. I do get it wrong sometimes, but people are definitely willing to correct you in a loving manner. And so far, the people I've come across understand that if you do trip it up, it's not because you want to disrespect them, their beliefs, but rather because it's something that you're not accustomed to. But yeah, that was definitely a huge cultural shock for me. The next big cultural shock for me, this one really took me aback, was the way parents and children speak to each other. And again, I don't want to have to keep repeating myself and saying this is not for everyone. Of course it's not for everyone. No one statement can ever cover every single person, except for the fact that we all have blood in our bodies, but you get my point. Anyway, the way parents and children speak to each other. So for instance, I've noticed that some American parents really do swear at their children. They throw F-bombs and B-bombs. Like, you have some people who call their parents the B-word, like as in B-I-T-C-H, I don't swear. I try my best not to swear. So I can't actually say the words. But like, parents actually swear at their children, and children swear back at their parents. Or even if it's not swearing at your parents, but you being able to use swear words around your parents. Personally, neither my mom nor my dad have ever heard me use a swear word, or at least not something that I consider to be a swear word. And that's not just because I personally don't choose to cuss, but because I would never dare use a certain language with my parents.
Don't try it too.
Because they would smack me. As big as I am, as tall as I am, I feel like my mom would definitely punch me in the face. Okay, that's a bit much. Not punch me in the face, but she definitely make me come correct with my language. And equally so, I've rarely ever heard my parents swear. And even if they do swear, it's never them swearing at me or when they're referring to me. You know what I mean? Or maybe I'm just considering the English version of it. I mean, we all know our parents sometimes here and they'll be like, hey, your donor or something like that. But as for like actually swearing as part of regular daily life, or often swearing at me or your children, that's not something that I've personally seen in any of the homes I've been in SA or in my own family. So that has been a huge shock to me. I remember when I first heard it, I was like,
somebody come and look at this. Look at this.
Because I was expecting the parents to react and be like, yeah, why are you? You know what I mean? But there was none of that. And another cultural shock that relates back to family is the whole bringing boyfriends and girlfriends back to your family.
In an African household, what is a boy, guys?
That's something that I've seen to be common here in America, in both black families, Latino families, white families, just families as a whole. Again, not everyone, but a lot of them are free to bring their boyfriends and girlfriends to their parents' homes or even tell them about it. Honestly, for me, my parents don't even want to know. They made it very clear for me that they don't want to hear anything like that. They don't want to see anyone in their house that I'm calling my boyfriend.
You type that elsewhere. Don't bring that here.
They always make it very clear that anyone you bring to this home has to be your husband. You know what I mean? I always wonder about that. So should I just come with someone and be like, oh, by the way, I'm engaged? Oh, what are the vibes? But anyway, here in America, I've noticed that a lot of kids are free to tell their parents, this is my boyfriend. And then if they break up with a boyfriend, they can bring the next one whenever it is and be like, this is my boyfriend. And the parents actually welcome these people in. They come over for dinner. You know, they want them to be there by the house, which for me is a huge cultural shock, because which African parent in South Africa is ever gonna say, yeah, let's bring him over here. We're gonna give him some papen and commas. Nah, my boy. Even if my mom said that, I'd feel like it was a trap. But again, of course, there are some families in South Africa, although I feel like it's more common with white people, but there are some families in SA that do allow you to bring your partners over and even go on vacations and blah, blah, blah. Personally, for me, can't relate. The next cultural shock for me that I have found to be true, again, I can't speak for the whole American nation, I generally feel like Americans are oversharers. Like, they will share everything with you, even if you guys don't even know each other that well. Like, there have been some instances where people come and tell me about their sex lives, they show you pictures, they show you videos, and you guys aren't even close, you're not even best friends or anything like that. Or people will just come to you and tell you, yeah, my dad left when I was two. And it's like, I feel like generally as South Africans, we don't tend to overshare. Like, my business is my business. Why do you want to know my business? I beg, mind your business. Even me, I'll mind my business. And you share with people who are like your friends or your family. You don't just share with anyone. I generally feel like Americans are oversharers. Personally, I feel like this cultural differences actually makes a difference in making friends. So you might find that I might be seen as more closed off, or maybe not as friendly or sharing, because I'm not gonna come to you and tell you about my life when you don't need to know, or when you don't know me like that, versus someone who will come to me and tell me everything, and then when it's my turn, I'll be like,
I like cereal!
So I do think that it does kind of affect relationship building, because you might be seen as standoffish. Something about relationships, again, is that I found that the relationship between old people and young people is very, very friendly. So if you're South African, and especially if you're black, I know your parents taught you to have respect for your elders. You can't say certain things with elders. You can't speak a certain way with elders. Basically, they are not your friends. have no business speaking to older people as if they're your friends. You have to keep it respectful or professional based on the environment. But I found that here in America, generally, old people, young people are very friendly. They call each other by their names. Like, there have been some older people who told me, call me by my name, and it's been so uncomfortable for me. Like, I can feel my mom watching me, waiting for me to call them by their name so she can be like, hey!
Look at you.
So that's definitely been a shock when I am engaging with people who are older than me and they want me to be very friendly. And if I'm not friendly in that way, then again, it makes me seem standoffish, kind of weird, you know what I mean? So the last bit of cultural shocks I'm not gonna go into too much detail about is sort of me throwing them in as fun facts. So number one, the legal drinking age in America is 21. If you are from South Africa or any country that has a legal age of 18, you're gonna be in for a huge surprise when you come to America and suddenly you go from being legal to being illegal by a whole 3 years.
It's upsetting me and my homegirl.
The next thing is, here in America, there are drive-through ATMs. Hello, guys. Drive-through ATM. Niti, you don't have to leave your car. You just... That, for me, was an absolute shock because, obviously, in SA, unless I've missed out on something, we don't have that. But also, you know, the way the crime is set up in SA, you'll go to your drive-through ATM and then when you're done, there'll be someone behind you ready to rob you, someone in front of you ready to rob you. So maybe it's for the best that we don't have those kinds of things. Next thing is self-service at grocery stores. Personally, I have not seen this in SA stores. Maybe I've missed something, but I've not seen this. But in America, you don't always have to go to a cashier to pay for your stuff. Instead, there are self-service queues where you pay for everything yourself. And of course, there are people who do take advantage of this and do try to steal. But apparently, there are cameras in the stores where they watch you. And if you take things so many times, they put you on a blacklist or something like that. I read about that on Twitter. But yeah, self-service is a thing. And more often than not, the self-service lines are actually longer than the lines with a cashier. The next point in line with the whole self-service things, there are no petrol attendants in America. In most states, there are no petrol attendants. It is also self-service. You have to do the thing yourself. Yo, guys, I don't know personally if I could have survived because when I first got a car, even now, I'm still sure I don't know much. But like, sometimes my car would light weird things like on the car, weird symbols that I don't understand. And I would literally go to a garage or a petrol station and I'd be like, yo, my brother, chief, what does this sign mean? Or even when they want to check my oil and water, I keep forgetting where the button is, bruh. So I go to the guys and I'm like, yo, my guy, like, you're gonna have to look with me because I have no idea where this thing is. And they help me. I don't know if I could survive without petrol attendants in this life, but in America, you just have to. Going on with the theme of cars, in America, you drive on the other side. So in America, the steering wheel is not on the right hand side, left, right, but it's actually on the left hand side. And you know how in SA it's keep left, pass right? Well, in America, they drive on the right hand side. So for those of you who are drivers, that's gonna be a bit of a shock for you. So once you've navigated how to drive in America, you're gonna realize that there is a fast food joint in almost every single corner that you turn. Burger King, McDonald's, Wendy's, Taco Bell, you name it. There are so many fast food joints in America and it's relatively cheap. There's something called 4 for $4 where you get these four items for $4, guys. So fast food joints are everywhere. The last point that I want to bring up is the diversity. I know that as South Africa, we are the rainbow nation because we have all sorts of people, but America's crazy, guys, because everyone is from somewhere. People are from different countries. You have Haitians, you have Jamaicans, you have people from other Caribbean countries, you have Nigerians, you have South Africans, you have Europeans, you have all sorts of people, and they come together and they have interracial relationships, which makes a whole new type of person with different types of diversity. America is really super diverse and I think it's so interesting. And also, I feel like generally a lot of Americans are really good looking, you know? Definitely, if you come to America, be prepared to see all different kinds of people. Personally, that's something that I think is really cool about America, is that you have all sorts of people from all sorts of countries. You can learn about so much culture and and different ways of cooking things. That's why I feel it's kind of dizzy for Americans to be anti-immigrants, because this place is land of the immigrants. The only real Americans are Native Americans. Everyone else, we're all guests, guys. I personally have loved the different kinds of people that you find in America, and I think it just adds spice to life. That's it for today, guys. I hope you liked this video. Don't forget to comment, like, share, and subscribe, and I will be back with more videos. Any videos that you want me to see, comment down below and I'll try and make it happen for you. But if you really want to get me to do it, check me out on Instagram. Peace and love, guys.